Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Just a couple of announcements. One is please remember to tear off that top section of your bulletin and put your name on it. Be prepared to drop it in the offering plate later in the service. Because this is Consecration Sunday, if you fail to do that today, you will get a letter tomorrow in the mail. So please do that, and so that we have a record of your attendance. Also, want to welcome Phi Mu Alpha Symphonia. We're grateful that you are singing with us today, helping to assist us in worship. And to Warner Durnell, who since August of 2012 has been the executive presbyter of the Presbytery of Middle Tennessee. We're grateful that he can be here. He served for 10 years as executive presbyter of the Presbytery of Northern Alabama, which is not too far from Middle Tennessee. Before that, for 10 years as pastor of St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Nashville. So we're grateful that he can join us today. He has announced his retirement as of August 1st of this coming year. I will invite you, when he comes forward, to give him a very warm welcome and thank you for his years of service to us. One last announcement. There is an angel tree. It is in the hall in the administrative area just outside the office. I invite you to take an angel if you haven't done so already and buy a gift for a family that is in need so that the child can celebrate Christmas this year. If you're able, please rise and join me in the call to worship. Give thanks to the Lord, for God is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Keep silence before the Lord God. Almighty God, you have named us enlighten us and make us children of light. Yet we reside in darkness. We settle for the seeming security and comforts of home, where our talents may be tucked away, our gifts preserved but paralyzed. You call us to live in faith, investing in the world you made, to exercise our gifts, even at the risk of losing them. Have mercy upon us, Lord. Have mercy. Help us understand your will for us. Teach us what you desire. Embolden us to steward well the gifts that you have entrusted, that one day we might fully enter your joy. Now hear our silent personal prayers. Hear this assurance from the same apostle. At the bedrock of the Reformation, we declare that our righteousness is found in Christ alone. It is a free gift from God. It is not something that we have earned. So in the name of Jesus Christ, I declare to you, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
tithe into the storehouse, and then I will pour out so many blessings, you will not have enough room for them. Wow. Imagine that there's so many good things that you don't have room for. So let's talk about the good things that God gives us every day. He gives us family. He gives us friends. He gives us trees, all these beautiful colors in fall. He gives us oceans, beaches, and so he gives us things all day long that we don't even think about. So I have a story. I have 10 beads in my hand. So let's pretend we live in a world where there's beads stand for money. And everything we use beads for. So what's one thing we need? A house, right? So a house costs 3 beads. Anybody like to eat? We need food, right? So they cost 2 beads. So we've already used half of our beads, haven't we? Then we want to have a car to go places, right? It's kind of hard to walk to Nashville, right? So that uses 3 more beads. And then you like to have clothes on, right? It's kind of cold outside without a jacket. That costs 2 more beads. Uh-oh. We don't have anything left to give to the church. We don't have anything left to give to God. So let's start with it. We did something wrong, right? So the word tithe means that you give 1/10 and you give it before you do anything else. So now we can put 1 bead in and that goes to the church. Why do we need to give money to God and to the church? God doesn't buy clothes or food or a house, right? Forget. To help the homeless and to help other people and to feed people and to take care of families when there's a flood or a storm or maybe during the holidays when they need to get home to friends. So the church does things like that. So now we've given our 1 to the church and we have 9 more. You can do whatever you want to with all those 9. Remember our 3 cups? You give 3 for saves. You give 3 to spend. And you give 3 for charity. Remember that from last week? Okay, so let's stand and say a quick prayer and we'll go back to Children's Church and talk about this more. Want to hold hands? Don't step on Miss Carolyn's foot. You can hold Miss Carolyn's foot. There you go. Dear God, help us to remember to give to you first so that the church can help others. Amen. Let me go first.
Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me the 5 talents, but here I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also had the 2 talents, came forward saying, Master, you delivered me 2 talents, here I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. He also, who had received the 1 talent, came forward saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not winnow. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. But his master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sowed and gather where I have not winnowed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have abundance. But from him who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. There then will weep and gnash their teeth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning. Now, I know you're out there. I see you. I'd love to be able to hear you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. It's good to be with you on this Lord's Day, to share with you on this special Sunday, your Consecration Sunday, 2017. I'm grateful to be graced by the brothers up to my right and to my left. Appreciate you sharing your gift of music and song this morning. I tell you what, I would that I could sing like you, but we won't go there. But I'm grateful that you're here this morning. Thinking of all the places where you could be, you know, for you to be here, we thank God. We thank God. Your pastor has shared with you that I have announced my retirement. I did so at our October meeting of the presbytery. I wanted to give the presbytery an opportunity to put in place a succession plan. At least that's what I publicly announced. Privately, I remember going to a Tampa Bay Rays game when the Yankees were playing a few years ago, and Derek Jeter was on his last year before retirement. And from stadium to stadium, they would award him gifts. And that night, he got a what was it now? He was a kayak. Oh, this long kayak painted in Yankee pinstripes. So I'm kind of halfway hoping. I'm halfway hoping. What to do with a grain of rice? The story is often told, perhaps you have heard it, that there was this king who had 3 daughters, no sons. There was no apparent heir. Now, this king, as he advanced in years, had this strong impression that he ought to go off by himself to spend time alone with God. But before leaving the royal palace, before leaving his realm, he called in all 3 of his daughters, and into each of their hands he placed a single grain of rice. Then he kissed them on their cheeks and did them adieu. The first daughter thought to herself, this grain must have intrinsic value, or the king will not have given it to me. I will deem it precious. So she took that single grain of rice to her bedchamber, found a spool of golden thread, and she carefully wrapped that single grain of rice in that golden thread, and then placed it in her jewelry box, and put her jewelry box in one of her dresser drawers, for there it would be kept safe. Now the second daughter looked at her single grain of rice, and to her, she was a bit amused. It looks like every other grain of rice, and she simply flicked it to win. The third daughter, and the youngest daughter, looked at her grain of rice, and she pondered for herself, what is the meaning of this? Why did the king give to each of us a grain of rice? What to do with a grain of rice? I will study this matter, she thought. And so she did. Day after day, week upon week, until it finally dawned on her what she should do, and she did it. On this Sunday, in the year of our Lord, 2017, church leaders have chosen as the gospel text for this Sunday another of the parables of Jesus, a parable that today we find recorded by Matthew in the gospel book that bears his name. It is a part of the judgment discourse of Jesus that Matthew records in his book. It is the parable of the talents. In first century Palestine, a talent was a large sum of money, equal to 15 years' wages for a common day laborer. As a result of the popularity of this particular parable and its widespread use, talent came into the English language in the Middle Ages as a term for God-given gifts, abilities, and graces. But in this parable, in this story, mind you, talent equals money. Jesus told of a certain wealthy landowner who calls three of his servants together, and he places in their care talents. He gives to each as he believes each is able to handle. Each servant would determine how their particular gift would be managed or expended. To one, he gave 5 talents. To another, he gave 2 talents. And to a third, 1 talent. Then the landowner went away for many years. The first 2 servants bravely worked with what they had been given, and they doubled it. The third acted with caution, not wanting to risk losing what had been entrusted to him, afraid he hid his 1 talent by burying it in the ground. After some time, and without warning, the wealthy landowner returned. Learning of the prosperous trading of the first 2 servants, the landowner commends them. Well done, good and faithful servant. However, the fearful inactivity of the 3rd servant guarded the condemnation of the landowner. For failing to not even bank the 1 talent in order to earn interest on it, the landowner takes the 1 talent and gives it to the servant with 10. The 3rd servant then is banished into outer darkness. Although I think I get the gist of this parable of Jesus, I still find myself stumbling over the action and the words of the landowner, especially those words spoken on the heels of taking the 1 talent from the fearful and now empty-handed servant and giving it to the wise and most profitable servant, the one who had 10. For the landowner says, for everyone who has will be given more, and he will have abundance. this third servant's heart resulted in forfeiture of the little that he had. I mean, there seems something unfair about this. Where is the grace? For ones who have will be given more, and those who have not will be stripped of what they do have. I mean, is this the economy of the kingdom? And the only way I can make sense of this parable, to arrive at some semblance of righteousness or fairness, is to try to hear it in its context. In the context that Matthew places it, one of judgment. And Matthew 25 gives us three parables, back to back to back. First, the parable of the 10 virgins that calls for preparedness. And then the parable of the talents that we read today that calls for responsibility. And then the parable of the sheep and the goats that calls for compassion. At the end time, the righteous judge, the Son of Man, will rule over a process of judgment, leading to separation. The wise virgins, who with oil in their lamps make it into the marriage feast, will be separated from the foolish virgins who were too late to fill up their lamps. The fearful servant who buried his gift will be separated from the two other servants who made good upon their gifts. The sheep will be separated from the goats, just as the fearless and faithful servants will be separated from the slothful and selfish servants. These words of a wealthy owner in the parable of the talents really have nothing to do with the economic order of the kingdom of heaven, nor do they depict the dominant character of God. Rather, these words are a warning against slothful, fearful, neglectful use of gifts, be they time, talent, or money. To whom much is given, much is required. So to the faithful who expend their gifts wisely, there is every probability of meeting with divine favor. But for those of us who fail to act wisely and prudently with the gifts given to us, we risk meeting with divine disfavor in the end. In this season of stewardship, in this season of prayerfully considering the gifts that God has given to us and how we might manage and use them to advance the mission of the church, let us mirror, by the grace of God, as best we can, the prudent and industrious acts of the servants in the parable that Jesus told, who took what they had been given and doubled it. May we be given the wisdom to use our time and abilities and money to grow the church deep and wide with earnestness, devotion, and liberality. Know when it comes to our giving that we simply cannot outgive God. Did you hear me on that? We cannot outgive God. So instead of asking our head, what's the minimum gift we can give and get by, how about consulting our heart and asking, what might be the maximum gift that we can give? Daring to ask our heart, daring to ask God what is the maximum gift that we can give, we may find ourselves among the more extravagant givers here at First Presbyterian Church of Clarksville. Perhaps an additional hour of service weekly to the church. Perhaps, bringing out from the mothballs that ability that we've ignored far too long, and using that ability on behalf of the church's ministry. How about increasing by a few percentage points our financial contributions to the church? For in so doing, we may find ourselves among the magnanimous givers here in Clarksville. That text from Malachi that was shared with the children in the time with young disciples, it's a passage that I was introduced to in my collegiate years. In my freshman year, I became acquainted with the Christian group on the college campus where I matriculated. We were called the Militants for Christ. I remember this is back in the late 60s, early 70s. Militancy had its place then, as it does now. So I began to tithe my income when I came home that first summer after my first year. And much to my surprise, my father called upon me at the end of the summer and said, son, I'm not going to be able to send you back to school this year. You know, you have your other sister about to begin and your older sister in college. I can't afford three, so you're going to have to manage your own. I love my dad. He was a hardworking guy. I only wish he had told me that at the start of something. So I'm short. I'm short when it comes to paying my college bill. I go to college. Long story short, don't have it all. I meet with the treasurer. He says, so who's a friend of my dad? Doing well. He said, well, I'll give you 2 weeks. If you don't have 2 weeks, you have to go see the president. So I'm scrambling. I'm doing all I know to do. I'm selling things, books and other things, tapes and the like. 2 weeks come and go, still don't have it all. I might be close, but I don't have it all. The treasurer sends me to the president. Oh, I didn't want to go see him. So the president said, okay, I tell you what, since you're so close, we'll give you another couple of weeks to come up with. God is my witness, I had it all within 24 hours. Now, the adversary, the accuser, was whispering in my ears, you know what, if we hadn't tithed like you did, you might have had your tuition before the semester started. But I decided not to give in to that. I believe God was faithful, and if it was meant for me to be in class that semester, God would provide a way. Let me fast forward about 20 years, okay? Now I'm a dad, married, with three children on the roof, and expenses seem to be mounting. My parents never told me how much it cost to raise a child. And when I asked my mother about it, she said, well, if I had, I might not have had any grandchildren. I've been tired as a pastor, but things are tight. I'm seeing my children at times going without. And so I began to fudge on my tithe. I began to get less than a tithe. But I had no real peace about it. None. Car would start breaking down. You know, the clothes washer or dryer would need repair. I became reacquainted with that Malachi text which says, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts. I said, put you to the test? At your invitation, I'm going to do that. And so for 3 months, in the fall of 1 year, I began to keep track of every income and every expenditure, but my first check was to the church. The full tithe, full 10%. I said, God, I'm going to test you. God is my witness. And I hope I have too much sense in the line. God is my witness. That 3 month period, I brought in to unexpected income. And yes, to the penny, every portion of the tithe that I gave. It was though God said, I'm going to give you back every everything you have given to us, health and strength and love of family and friends and meaningful employment. You get my drift? God will not allow you to outgive God. Put God to the test. Now, for some of you, tithing is what you've been doing for quite some time, and you're quite comfortable with it. Perhaps God is calling you, as God has been calling me of late, to give more than a tithe. 12, 15%, 20%. Be a double tither, as I know some have been down through the years. Be among the extravagant givers, the magnanimous givers, here at First Presbyterian Church. Now, one of the risks of having announced your retirement is that you might preach longer than you should. So let me come to an end. Back to that story that I began with. You know that third daughter who studied what to do with that single grain of rice and then she did it? The king eventually returned home, much to the delight of his three daughters. They embraced him there in the royal court. And afterwards he asked them, "Whatever became of the grain of rice that I gave you?" Oh, that first daughter, she rushed to her bedchamber. She found her jewelry box. She brought it with her, and then she reached inside and pulled out that grain of rice, still wrapped in the golden thread, and she placed it in the king's hand, and she said, "Father, here is that grain of rice. I've kept it safe all these years." And the king simply said, "Thank you, daughter. You may be dismissed." The second daughter, she knew she had to be quick with it. She had to scramble and do something. She raced to the royal pantry. She began to scrounge around on the floor, and she found in one of the corners, the dank corners, a grain of rice that must have been there for quite some time. It was hardened and blackened, but she took it and she went back to the king and she said, "Here, Father, here's the grain of rice." The king knowingly said, "Thank you, daughter. You may be dismissed." The third daughter approaches the king and she says, "Father, I do not have the grain of rice that you gave me." "Oh, no," he said, "whatever came of it." She said, "Well, for days upon days, I began to study what to do with a grain of rice until it finally dawned on me, and I did it." "Whatever did you do?" the king asked. She said, "Come, let me show you." And so this third daughter carries her dad out through the rear door of the royal palace, through the royal garden, up a hill, and once she gets to the crest of the hill, she explains, "Father, I took that grain of rice and I planted it in soil. And I poured water on it, I gave it sunlight, and in time it sprouted a shoot. And from its stalk, several grains of rice. I took those grains of rice out, planted them carefully in moistened soil, and I watered it, and I gave it sunlight, and in time, several sprouts began to emerge, and I took from its stalks rice grains, and I planted them, and I repeated that procedure time and time again, until eventually I had a whole paddy of rice. And from that paddy of rice, I began to plant fields of rice. What we could not eat here in the royal palace, we sold, and I was able to hire workers who planted even more fields of rice. And so now, as far as the eye can see, there is rice paddy after rice paddy after rice paddy." The king, without saying a word, simply took the crown off of his head and placed it on this third daughter's head and smiled.
Come to you, good shepherd of our souls. You lead us beside still waters and into green pastures. You truly satisfy our every need. You invite us to cast every care we have on you. You invite us to come in faith, trusting you with our very lives, and calling on you in prayer. So in faith, this morning we pray for your church. In this season of Thanksgiving, grant us grateful hearts. And as you are the head of the church, help us to live faithfully as the body of Christ. Help us to continue his mission in our world. In faith, we also pray for the earth, grateful for the bounty of the harvest and the laborers that you send into the fields, and for all who prepare and serve our food. And we pray for the day when the whole earth will make a joyful noise to you and sing a song of praise and thanksgiving for your coming and your new creation. Faith, we pray for all the nations where there is violence and strife and turmoil. We pray for your justice and your peace. Come and save us, driving out those wolves in sheep's clothing who abuse the weak and scatter your flock. In faith, this morning we pray for our own community. Help us to see Christ among our neighbors, serving those who are hungry and thirsty and naked and lonely and sick or in prison. Hear our cries for those whom we love. Pray especially for our sister Liz Thomas as she mourns the death of her husband Joel. Be her strength and her comfort. Embrace her with your love and the love of family and friends. And assure her of the promise that you will never leave or forsake her. We're grateful this morning that for Joel, the pain of Parkinson's is over. That he rests eternally with you. We continue to pray for healing and quick recovery from surgery for John Waddle and for Vicki Duncan. Pray especially for Don Deck this morning, for Marita and their children as they care for him. In your mercy, hear our prayers for Shannon Wall Conkle, for Ruby Jean, for Rick, for Tom, for Carolyn, for Larry. You are our loving shepherd. Lead us, guide us. Help us to find bright paths, even in dark valleys, until we finally feast with you in glory and dwell in your house forever. And teach us again to pray as Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, Jesus said to give to the emperor, to give to Caesar the things that belong to Caesar, and to give to God the things that belong to God. So with grateful and thankful and generous hearts, let us give a portion of what we have received, return it to God. Your offerings will now be received.
Thank you. Thank you.
the ushers to come forward and at this time to distribute among the congregation the estimate of giving cards. Make sure that everyone has one, at least one per household. You are being asked to indicate on these cards the level of commitment you are making for the coming calendar year. If it's more than a tithe, or if you're tithing or on the way to tithing, please check one of those boxes on your card. Then you are being asked to fill out the line that says, "My commitment is," there's a dollar sign and a line underneath, "per week." Again, this is your pledge per week. If you give bi-monthly or seasonally or annually, if you can, do the math. It's not that hard. If you have trouble, just move the decimal point to the right. If the amount of your gift this year represents an increase over what you gave in 2017, would you indicate that as well? Check the box if you're giving for the coming year, at least your intention, is that of exceeding your gift from the current year. Now please do fill in your name and contact information, if you would, on the lines provided. When you have finished filling out your card, please fold it in half. It may be that the written portion is on the inside. Know that Monica Drake and Michelle Hodge, members of your stewardship committee, will record the estimate of giving and will report back to your pastor to the officers for them. Stewardship committee, once you have completed your card, would you come forward? Those of you who are on the stewardship committee, if you would come forward and place your pledge in the baskets. Someone comes. see there's an usher at the door. I don't know if there are those in the hallway who need to come, if they would proceed forward. We want you to take your time. There's no rush to this. Take your time. And if you would, let's start from the rear. Begin coming forward and placing your pledge on the card. You can come down these two centermost aisles, and then we turn back to the outer one. That everyone who has made it a point to indicate the estimate of giving for next year has done so by placing or having placed your card in the basket. They will be taken and counted, and perhaps before the midday meal is over, you'll know exactly what the total is. I'm going to call the pastor if he would come at this time and to offer a prayer over these pledges, these estimates of giving for next year. May it be that God will give us the grace to live into these intentions and even beyond these intentions.
Let us offer our thanks and also for the meal that we are about to receive. Let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the fact that these intentions represent for us blessings that you've already given. We pray that you would take and use the gifts that we bring for your kingdom throughout this coming year. And we pray with thanks for the meal that we are about to receive and for this season of wonderful food. We thank you for those who grew our food and prepared it and now who serve it today. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Would you please rise for the charge of benediction? Go forth as the people of God, as followers of Jesus Christ, to maximize the gifts that God has given you, of time, talent, and treasure. for the advancement of His kingdom, for the mission of the church. And may the grace, mercy, and peace of God, Creator, Christ, and Counselor go with you and before you both now and always. Amen.